If you would take your Bibles with me and turn to Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. Again, my intentions as I began this week was to get back into Romans 7, but it just didn't work out that way. I ended up with this particular passage in my mind, and I just couldn't get away from it. So I thought I'd preach a message. I've entitled this message, Come Unto Me. Come unto me. You know, I remember, it seems like yesterday, but it's been over 30 years ago, Henry and Mahan, my mentor, the one I heard the gospel from, I heard him say several times from the pulpit, and this is so true, it's just as relevant today as it was when I first heard it from him 30 years ago. He said, men will come to the front, they'll come to the fount, they'll come to one another. But they will not and they cannot of their own come to Christ. But that's where we come. Now, we got to come to Christ. Several years ago, and it's been, I look back to make certain, it was like 2016. I preached a message, and I would encourage you to go out there and listen to it. The name of the message was The Gospel Hidden and Revealed. The Gospel Hidden and Revealed. Came from this same chapter that we're going to look at this morning. And I tell you that, and you need to, I actually really don't need to go listen to it. I'm going to kind of preach the sermon to you in a condensed format this morning. Because here's the thing, in order to understand the meaning and the context of our Lord's words, and these comforting words that we're going to get to, come unto me all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You got to understand it and its setting in this greater context of our Lord's discourse here in Matthew chapter 11. Look back up at verse 25. At that time, now this is right after our Lord said that it would be, it said in verse 21, woe unto you, thee Chorazin, woe unto thee Bethsaida, for if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. And the religious world, they read something like that and they think, well, then why didn't, if that's the truth, why didn't, if you know, think about it, if what had been done in Chorazin and Bethsaida had been done in Tyre and Sidon, God, by his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, tells what would have happened. They would have repented. They would have. So the religious world says, well, then why didn't he go do it? Why, if that's the case, if those truths had been revealed there, why not reveal those truths there? The sovereignty of God. It wasn't his will. He repeats, I say unto you, it'd be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment for you. And thou Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shalt be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which had been done in thee had been done where? In Sodom, which is no longer exists, it would have remained until this day. Again, why not do it? Why not go there? If you get guaranteed results, go where the guaranteed results are going to be at. It wasn't God's will. Listen, those people in Sodom and Gomorrah, those people in Tyre and Sidon, the long and the short of it is this. They were vessels of wrath fitted for destruction, just like Judas Iscariot. Our Lord said of Judas, it would have been better had you never been born. Born for one reason, Kenny. One specific reason. And so it's in that context, it says, at that time, after he's made that statement, Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, underline and highlight and put an asterisk before this next phrase, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes, even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. Now keep in mind, and you got to keep this in mind, what is this that our Lord's doing? I thank thee, O Father. What's that? It's a prayer. And not is it just a prayer, it's not just saying, it's a prayer of thanksgiving. And what does the sweet, loving, compassionate kind, like no other man, thank his Father for? I thank you, Father, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent. Boy, that's a lot different in this world. God wants everybody to see this. Christ died for everybody. Christ shed his blood indiscriminately for all men. Folks, you can't find that in this book. That's a lie that has been propagated by men and women who are uninstructed, and untaught by the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you what, this is the thing. God saves who he will. Somebody put something this week and said, well, then I don't guess it's God's will for every man to be saved. Because if it was his will for every man to be saved, what would every man be? See, that's the difference between our God and their God. They got a God who wants to and can't, or wouldn't. We serve a God who does and don't care less what you think. That's why he's G-O-D. He is a supreme divine being in need of nothing. Nothing. But we've also got to remember, he thanks the Father for hiding it, but thankfully he gives thanksgiving to the Father as well. For what? For the fact that this same God who hid the truth from the wise and prudent, what's he done? He's revealed the gospel to babes. And here's the way that he characterizes these babes in Christ Jesus. From Christ's own words, he says of every babe in Christ Jesus, you know what you're doing? Laboring and heavy laden. You know a characteristic of a babe in Christ? Laboring and heavy laden. We'll get to that at the end of the message this morning. So the question that we begin with this morning, are you laboring and heavy laden today? That's the question. Are you and me, are we constantly aware, and I am so aware of this every day that I live, are you constantly aware of the ongoing struggle or warfare that continually rages in your life as one who has rested? And I have. I've rested in Christ as the Lord my righteousness. Have you? But it seemed like when I rested, and it didn't seem like, it was, when I rested in Christ as the Lord my righteousness, instead of the battle cooling, what happened? Because here's the thing. Before he reveals himself to us and in us, we're not in the battle. We're in a battle with our own guilt, our own conscience, and the other men and women's guilt and consciences as well. But we're not in a struggle between flesh and spirit until we're in the spirit. You know, you wonder sometimes, and I've thought about this a lot in my lifetime, especially as a justified saint. You wonder, why didn't he just take all this out of us? Huh? Well, obviously, there's a reason why things are the way that they are. If it were not God's will for us to have a warfare between the flesh and the spirit, folks, the warfare would be gone. And I know this much, all things work together for good to them that love God. What? Including the warfare. I'm convinced in my own life that if God did take it out of us, you know what we'd be? We'd be a bunch of self-righteous, almost called us what we are. We would be some of the most self-righteous judges on the planet. Looking at it and wondering all the time, why aren't they doing what I'm doing? But here's the thing. If you haven't by God-given faith came to Christ, come to him, or if you've come to him, and I hope that you have, and you're still filled with doubt and fear, I think Christ has a word of comfort for you this morning. Because after thanking God the Father for the fact that he exercised his sovereign will and right to reveal or make known the Son to whomsoever he wills or chooses, notice Christ's next words after that. I thank God that you've hid it from the wise and prudent, revealed it unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. He doesn't stop. What does he say next? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. You know, in the scriptures, particularly in the New Testament, when Christ or his apostles use words like believe, or trust, or follow, or as in the case of our text this morning, he uses this word come. All those words are synonymous. They mean the same thing. So what are we talking about? These terms mean a whole lot more. Follow, trust, believe, come. It means a whole lot more than just giving mental agreement with or an outward profession of one's belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that to be the case because of Christ's words in the Sermon on the Mount. Because he says that many at that day, what are they going to cry? They're going to cry, Lord, Lord. They're going to even do it their whole lives. They've made it to the judgment, having convinced themselves that they know him and have come to know him. At the judgment, they find out what? They've been in error. Listen to this. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. And we always say, everybody, see, that's the thing. Everybody jumps on that thing, whosoever doeth the will of my Father and is in heaven. And most people, when they see that doing the will of the Father which is in heaven, what do they think about? They think about law keeping. Before Christ has got to Rome, Matthew 7, where he makes this statement, he's already shown everybody what the will of the Father is, absolutely considered, can't do it. Can't do it. So what is it the will of the Father? This is my Father's will, that you believe on him whom God has sent. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. That's the strangest verse in the scriptures. I mean, you think about it the way we were taught all our lives, preaching, casting out demons, doing wonderful works. Those are good things. And in essence, in reality, they are good. It's good to preach the gospel, is it not? It's good to, it would have been good, especially at that time. Don't you think it was good for that Gadarene demoniac to have those demons cast out of him? It's good to do many wonderful works. We should do many wonderful works, all of us. Our salvation doesn't rest on those works. And it's not even evidenced by those works, folks. But he says of those who did all these things and are sitting there talking about doing all those things, what does he say? I never knew you. That word knew is that Jewish idiom for a relationship, the most intimate relationship between a man and a woman that results in a child. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore him a son. So what's he saying here? I never loved you. That's what he's saying. Oh, God loves everybody. Well, I know one person he didn't love. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. And that's that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. But he calls them what? Workers of iniquity. Does that mean that me preaching the gospel this morning, I'm a worker of iniquity? I'd be a worker of iniquity if I thought that my preaching the gospel makes the difference between saved and lost. You would be a worker of iniquity if you think that some work that you've done makes a difference between saved or lost, makes you more qualified, more fit, more entitled for eternal life. You're a worker of iniquity. See, this coming of which our Lord Jesus Christ speaks in our text, it's believing in Christ as he's revealed by the Holy Spirit and God's Word. But here's the thing. The thing about it is, coming to me, all ye that heavy laden, is to believe in Christ as he is revealed in God's Word. The book. But we've got a problem. Christ said, no man can come to me. Now listen, coming to me, all ye labor here. No man can come to me except it the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will in no wise cast him out. He also said this, all that the Father giveth me shall come unto me. You're coming to me, all ye that labor. All that the Father has given me, what are they going to do? They're going to come to Christ. And him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. So the very act of any sinner coming to Christ, coming to God, one who's laboring and heavy laden in sin, the very work itself, whose work is it? It's not their own faith, and it's not their free will. Listen to you. Then said he unto them, what? Then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? In other words, give us something to do where we can get life. Christ responds. Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God. And here's the work of God, that you believe on him whom God hath sent. So what does that tell me? It tells me the same thing Philippians chapter 1 verse 29 tells me. For unto you it is given on the behalf of Christ not only to believe on his name. You see that? This is the work of God. For unto you it is given on behalf of Christ not only to believe on his name, but to suffer for his name's sake. So the very act of coming, the very act of believing, the very act of faith, it's not something you worked up by your own free will. It's a gift of God. And see, Christ had already confirmed this to be the case by his words in the previous verse. All things are delivered unto me of the Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father, save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. You see that? Those who come to Christ correctly, you know how they come? They come as sinners. They come as altogether ungodly. They come as those who are without faith. And how do they come? They come to a full, suitable, willing, and able Savior, trusting him alone for righteousness, life, salvation, and eternal life. Yeah, I don't think there's any more fitting language in the Scripture to describe the Lord Jesus Christ as those of a shepherd. I am the good shepherd. I lay down my life for who? Sheep. But notice the next part of this verse. Christ tells us who those are that will and do come to him for righteousness and salvation. All ye that labor and heavy laden. All ye that labor heavy laden. Keep in mind the context who Christ is addressing in these words. Look back up at verse 19. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a wine bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. Who's the they say? Who's he talking about here that are making this kind of a statement? Because Christ did come eating and drinking, right? John the Baptist came neither eating nor drinking. What did they say of John? He's a devil. Christ, on the other hand, comes eating and drinking. What do they say? They say he's a gluttonous man, which our Lord was not a glutton. He was not a wine bibber. You never find any evidence anywhere throughout the Scriptures that our Lord was ever drunk. He was temperate, just like we are to be temperate. Be not drunk with wine. I know that our Lord, who wrote that law, would not turn around and break that law. But here's the thing. He was the friend of who? The hopeless, the helpless, the publicans, the sinners, the ones that these self-righteous, religious, moral, sincere, dedicated religionists thought that they deserved death and condemnation. So who's he talking to here? Who's the ones that's making this statement about our Lord Jesus Christ? The scribes and Pharisees. Why did they think this of our Lord Jesus Christ? Because they were doing the exact opposite. They were doing their dead level best to avoid every single solitary thing that they considered to be disobedience to both God's law and man's law as they wrote it. Yet in reality, what were they? They were burdened with burdens that they themselves could not even bear. Our Lord said to them, and the way they treat others that are sinners by birth, by nature, by practice, and by choice, isn't this the way the self-righteous deals with everybody? They bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Hypocrites. Well, these Christ encouraged to come, they're not religious folks who are laboring in the service of Satan, seeking to produce a righteousness of their own. These religious men weren't seeking rest for their souls because they thought they were already righteous. These men are the ones that the Apostle Paul talked about in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 15, when he wrote, "Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works." So all ye that labor and heavy laden, who's it directed at? It's directed at every sinner. Listen, every sinner who's burdened with the guilt of sin of their own consciences, pressed down with the unsupportable yoke of the law, as well as the load of human traditions they've labored under until they are completely weary of trying to obtain peace of conscience and rest for their souls by the observance of all those things. Are you tired of all of that? Well, these are encouragements. What are they encouraged to do? Try harder. Put your shoulder back to the grindstone and push it with all you might. No, come to Christ. Lay all your burdens at his feet. Look to and lay hold on him by faith, his person, his blood, his righteousness, his sacrifice, so that we can enjoy, they can enjoy that true spiritual peace which could never be obtained by the works of the law. Listen to Paul. "And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses." I think about that a lot. I have so many people that are well-intentioned. They're good people, the way the world measures good people. But think about it. Do you not hear the law? Tell me, you that desire to be under the law, don't you hear it? They hear what they think it says. We see the depths to which the law goes, don't we? The law doesn't just stretch to outward acts. It stretches where? To the mind, to the will, to the very soul of man. And here's the thing. When you think about it, the only ones who are going to come to him are hungry and thirsty. Right? Because I tell you, only the hungry and thirsty are the ones who seek water or food. That's why I read Isaiah 55 to you. "Ho, everybody that thirsts, come to the water." Right? You got to be thirsty. You got to be thirsty. Most folks I know aren't thirsty. They have no desire for righteousness they had no part producing or maintaining. They want to be able to say, "I did thus and so. I changed my life. Now, I did it with Christ's help, but I still changed my life. I got up, and where I wasn't going to church, I started going. Where I didn't read the book, I started reading the Bible. Where I didn't pray, I started praying." I tell you, you pray into a God you cannot save. And it's the same way with all those that come to Christ spiritually. You've got to be made to hunger and thirst after him. Solomon, in his wisdom, as he wrote of the church in her blackness, as she saw herself, the church cries out to Christ, "Draw me. Draw me. And we'll run after you." If he don't draw us, folks, we're not running. God evermore keep us drawn. Every day. But notice the final thing that we see here. Notice the results of the effect of all those who are laboring and heavy laden and drawn by the Father, the Son, coming to him as the Lord their righteousness. "And I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." You know me in words. I got to looking at the words again. I love this Greek word that's translated rest. You know what it means in the original? Think about this. Every time you see, just about without exception, when you see the word rest, it's particularly as it relates to the child of God in relationship to God, it means to cause or permit one to cease from any movement or labor in order to recover or collect his strength. What does that mean? Stop. Stop. That's impossible for the natural man. I have had so many people that I've talked with about the gospel through the years, and they sit there and they listen. I've even seen them, some of them listen and just have tears in their eyes as they listen to the truth as we portray Christ in both his glorious person and work. And they get to the end of it as you're talking to them about Christ and righteousness obtained through his obedience unto death. And they immediately get done, and you know what they say? Well, what about? They've missed the message. There's no whatabouts. There's no ifs. There's no, well, I believe all that, but. When people start adding buts to the gospel, they've left the gospel. Now, they have. This rest that Christ promised his people, folk, it's spiritual rest. It's not peace out here. I'm going to tell you what, this ain't peace in this world we're living in right now, is it? I'm 62 years old, and this is, other than getting to spend more time with my wife than I've got to spend with her in the last 25 years, this is misery, this world. Huh? To watch our economy failing and to watch all the problems and watch the death, 50,000 people dead. It's tragic. It's tragic. It's troubling in your heart and in your mind. And I can't find any peace in it. But I tell you, he told me in the world what you're going to have. Tribulation. But he says if we come to him, what do we get? In the midst of tribulation, we get rest. We get comfort and peace and security where we can. I think about Noah all the time, don't you? He built that boat, sure enough, according to God's directions. Pitched it within and without, and that pitch is it's kofar, it's an atonement, is what it is. It's the Hebrew word which is translated atonement. And he pitched it on the inside, pitched it on the outside. That ark is Christ. Strange thing about that ark, there's one door in, there's no rudder. There's no way to propel it. When the time comes and God's wrath is about to pour out on this earth, God puts him inside that ark. God brings him into the ark, doesn't he? Go read the story. God shut the door and sealed it, and they broke open the rain, the water from the depths, and the flood came, right? He had no control. All Noah could do, there was no steering wheel he could grab a hold of and say, well, I'll keep this thing away from that mountain yonder. Actually, there was only one window to look out of. But listen, he heard every clap of thunder. He felt every movement of the boat. He felt every contact and impact that it had against anything it ran into. And it did. You go out there to the lake now, at Lake Darbon where we fish, there's junk with all this flood water. There's stuff floating that you got to be so careful. You can't go wide open. You run over a tree floating out there. Everything, he felt it. He heard it. That sucker rocked around too. But what did he have to do? He had to rest in the one who had gave him the directions of how to build a boat. You build this boat this way. Well, God built this eternal ark in Christ Jesus our Lord. And we're safe in him. Doesn't mean we don't feel it all and don't have to go through it. He had to go through that flood. Well, we got to go through this life. Israel had to go through. They didn't kill their enemies, and what happened? They had to deal with them. Like God said, destroy them utterly. They didn't do it. What did they do? For the rest of their lives, they dealt with those enemies just making, like I think about the Viet Cong, making those little sneak attacks the rest of their life. And what are we? Same way with us. Adam's not dead, huh? He's still very much alive, and we fight with him every day, do we not? And see, this spiritual understanding is given to us by God the Holy Spirit. Regeneration and conversion brings comfort and rest, true rest, to the believing sinner's mind. Christ tells us that we'll find rest unto your souls. And it comes how? Learning of him. What do we learn of him? We're taught of God. What are we taught of God? Well, look at Philippians chapter 2. I'll show you what we're taught. We learn this of our Lord Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which is in Christ Jesus, which was also... So first of all, get this right in your mindset. It is our responsibility to let this mind be in us. Doesn't force it on us. It's our responsibility. Let this mind... What kind of mind did Christ have? Here it is. Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, being found in fashion as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. That is the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and every of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Even though Christ, even though the Lord Jesus Christ is eternal God, in order to save his people from their sins, what did he do? He willingly took into union with his divine nature a sinless humanity. And he did that in order to offer himself without spot to God for all the sins of all those whom he represented. And here's the thing I want you to get from this morning. If our blessed Lord went to such lengths to secure the eternal salvation of all those given to him by the Father in the everlasting covenant of grace, is there any possibility that any of those he came for, that he lived for, that he died for, that he rose again for, shall ultimately fail to enter into eternal rest? Is there any possibility? And the answer is what? Absolutely none. But there's one more thing. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. The law ain't easy. But hear me well, you're not under law. You're under grace. How in the world can it be said that Christ's yoke is easy and his burden's light? Well, while it's true that every justified saint is under Christ's yoke, we're under it as what? Willing bondslaves. Because what did Christ do? He bore our sins in his body on the tree. Christ's yoke is easy and that burden is indeed light because what did he do? He bore the entire burden. All of it. It's easy because, listen, it does not, this yoke that we have, this bond slave yoke that we have, it's not a burden of legal obedience, and it's not a burden of mercenary efforts. We're not doing it to gain a mansion over the hilltop or to get into the streets of gold. It's easy because, you know what it is? It's a yoke of love. Meaning the child of God willingly serves out of grace and gratitude to him who loved them and gave himself for them. Here's evidence of it. We love him. You hear that? The word there is agape. And that's something that I've said this before. I'll say it again. We do not have in us by name. Nobody that you know, nobody that I know, apart from those born by the Spirit of God, none of us have agape love. But those born of God, we do have agape love. We agape him. We love him with a godlike love. Why? Because he first loved us. I could get into a lot of things on that one verse. That blows all this idea of God loving everybody and trying to save him. Because everybody he loved, what do? They love him back. No ifs, ands, or buts about this. This is an absolute. We love, not we try to, or we want to, or we will. If we make up our mind, we love him. We agape him. Why? Because he loved us. In closing, let me ask you this question. Have you come to this Christ, trusting his perfect work as your Savior and Redeemer, resting in his righteousness alone? If so, according to God's promises, you know what you can and do find? You find rest. You find rest. But if you hadn't come to him, you hadn't rested in his righteousness, what do? I encourage you to flee from the wrath to come, seeking mercy and grace in Christ, because what is he called? We read it just a few moments ago there in Matthew chapter 11. They say he's the friend of publicans and sinners. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our griefs and pain to bear, right? He's the sinner's friend. If you see yourself as a sinner, you come to him. And I tell you what, you'll find out, you'll know. Because when you get there, you know what you find out? The only reason I'm here is what? He drew me with everlasting cords of love. Okay, let's stand together and we'll be dismissed. Kenny, if you would, lead us in a closing prayer, please.